So today we have an interview of somebody who started out growing up in the streets, being thrust into a violent, you know, area of town, having to survive, having to move around a lot to different places. And you get so good at violence, you get so good at understanding violence that your nickname becomes the animal because you're able to turn it on so quickly and so unexpectedly. And then you find out that people want to learn from you. And so you start teaching, and then you get so frustrated from teaching because you have to say things over and over and over again that you start writing things down. And then you find out, hey, I'm actually pretty good at this. People actually respond to my writing. And then your career takes a big change later in life to where you become really, I would say, the premier legal advocate for people that are being prosecuted for self-defense, meaning you protected yourself using, you know, physical force, a tool or something, and then you need a legal team to help explain why it's justified what you did. Well, I'm going to introduce you to that guy later on today. But first, as everybody knows, make sure you go over to SurviveViolence.com, sign up for the free masterclass, give us your email, subject matter experts like the one you're about to meet, and everybody else. I will be posting any relevant information on any new products, books, anything they have. Also, the latest stuff for us, any training seminars, any of that other stuff. And you're going to get first knowledge on any new stuff. It's really the only way we can guarantee that we can keep in touch with you. Now, make sure you also subscribe to the channel, you know, this YouTube channel. It's growing. We just hit a good milestone, and I really appreciate it. And if you could keep sharing the information, if there's a particular video that you liked, please send it to your friends. Let them know that this channel exists. All right. So today I get to meet one of the guys who, when I originally got into martial arts, combat sports, whatever you want to call it, reality self-defense, I always was looking for the idea of how to survive on the street. It was more important to me that I understood that than really the combat sport aspects of things. I had combat sports. There were many options for combat sports, you know, for me when I was going through this, but there weren't many people that could really talk to you and really give you good information on how to deal with real violence. Marc MacYoung is probably one of the original sources that I ever had. And Mark's a really interesting guy. You know, some of his books, some of you may be familiar with the old Paladin Press, and they had some sensational stuff. And that was my first introduction to Marc. It was titles like this. I'll pull up this one. Cheap shots, ambushes, and other lessons. I mean, you know, you got something with brass knuckles and super sensational titles like that. And for a young man, you know, looking to take care of yourself, especially somebody like me moving around to different cities all the time, getting jumped as the new kid, all that kind of stuff. This was useful information to me. And Marc communicated very well. In fact, his nickname was the Animal. I'll show you in this other title that he had here. This is the one I love. Pool cues, beer bottles, and baseball bats. I mean, that's awesome. The guys that wrote the titles at Paladin were amazing. But Mark's nickname was the Animal. And he got that deservedly so because he worked some really rough areas. He worked at a lot of very rough bars. He had real encounters and real violence. When this man talks, he's very, you know, jovial. He was just great. He gave me plenty of time. We got almost 2 hours done in an interview that I'll be breaking up into parts here. All really, really top-notch information. But listen, he can probably put you at ease in the way he talks, and you might say, oh, wow, he's just a really nice guy and everything. And he is a very nice guy and very patient. You know, he's very patient with my questions. But the man's the real deal. He's really done this. And so, again, looks can be deceiving at times when you see this, especially those of you that aren't familiar with him. But I think you're going to really, really enjoy what we're about to do with this interview. Now, we're going to take it in multiple parts. This first part is going to be, you know, basically about who he is, how he came up, and really there's just some just gold in here. But I'm really looking forward to the feedback that I get from this. Again, this series of interviews that I've been doing where I've been interviewing people who I've wanted to talk to. I've known of Marc for years. I don't even think we had any exchanges. You know, Rory and I had some exchanges before, but I've never actually, this is my first time I really actually got to talk to Mark, and it was fascinating. And you'll see me, you know, during it, I'm kind of really into the interview listening, and sometimes he's asking me questions and I'm not even realizing he's talking to me. So I have to catch up, but it was a great interview. And I think there's a lot of really good things we can unpack, but I'm going to let you get into it right now with Marc MacYoung. All right. Marc MacYoung, thank you so much for taking the time to do this interview.
Thank you. It's good to be here.
Hey, listen, I've followed you for years. I put you in the category of probably one of the originals, you know, from coming up. And what I mean by that is people prior to, say, the UFC explosion that were really known in the industry. And you were probably one of the first people. I remember getting one of your books, and I'll talk more about that, you know, later. But what was relatively quick was, you know, back, especially in the late 70s and early 80s and stuff, when we were getting books, everything, the titles were always sensational. And so what was interesting about that was, yeah, sure. Did I buy it? I'm a young guy. So did I buy it because it's going to teach me how to kick ass? Yeah, absolutely. But what was interesting was right from the get-go, you jarred people right away with your writing, your clarity, and what we thought we were going to get versus you were really good at delivering what people wanted, but then you also gave them what they needed.
Yeah.
And can you just talk about, you know, your background? I think another important thing people need to understand, and I'm just setting the stage for you, is the fact that you worked doors. I find that in the world of, what do you want to call it, self-defense, whatever, you know, self-protection, the people that have the best knowledge to give, they've worked some sort of a social situation where it was, you know, violence was definitely an option, but as far as human nature, that's what I got from you right away, was the fact that you were the first guy that jarred me in the idea that, hey, guess what, idiot, you can punch and kick all day, but if you don't know human nature and mm-hmm. you don't understand how the human animal operates and what the repercussions are, that struck me right away from the first, my first introduction to you. So I'll shut up now, and just, if you could just introduce yourself to these people and how you got to that stage.
Okay, now that is a long, strange trip. Basically, I grew up in the streets of Los Angeles being bounced around. I come from what is known as situational poverty, which is, after my parents, my mom and my stepdad divorced, we got reduced and put into poverty. Okay, so we were middle class here, and you know, most of my family was middle class, but we got dropped down into poverty. And that's where I encountered the difference between situational, like you're in the situation, and generational, right? And that's like generations that have been on welfare. And you know, being thrown into the streets, I had to learn how to survive. And it wasn't just, you know, punching, kicking, using weapons, et cetera, et cetera. A whole lot of it was I had to learn an entirely different lifestyle and perspective that these people, they've been, you know, raised it. They took it for granted, but I was an outsider, right? I was a new kid on the block, so to speak. And I had to study people like bugs to see what was going on. Now, that doesn't sound really exciting, but believe me, when it results in you getting shot at because you don't know the rules,
right,
it's like, maybe I should pay attention to this, make a note here, right? So things like the first time I ever got shot at, I was 12, 13, 14, I don't remember. I was on my way to buy comic books at the local liquor store, right? And somebody, because I was wearing a flannel shirt and lived between two gang territories, somebody mistook me as playing for the other team. And that's two things. Number one is where I learned first time what a bullet sounds like when it whips past you. as I refer to, it's like a bumblebee had Mexican food for lunch, right? As a whip. I also learned that n-dimensional space travel is possible. You can move from point A to point B with no time in between. Because when that bullet went, I was in a doorway, right? Crouched up, you know, because somebody just shot at me.
Yeah.
Right? And for nothing that I'd done. Now, later on, I'd be shot at for, you know, things I'd actually done. Right. But, you know, growing up with violence and, like, the first kid I ever knew who, well, let's see. Here's one of those things that a lot of people don't quite get. I talk about things like the first time I was shot at, the last time I was shot at, the first time I was looking down a cop's gun, the last time I was looking down a cop's gun, and all the times in between.
Right.
So, you know, when I'll have to hesitate now and then go, well, let me think about this. Okay, the first person I knew who died, the first time I saw a corpse, I was like 5 years old. And this guy was just freshly manufactured. He was bloody laying there. And that was when I realized I could die doing this stuff. You know, death was real.
Right.
Then I knew kids who got killed, you know, knew people who suicide, who also knew, you know, people who had stabbed and shot each other. And then there comes, you know, the first time I stabbed somebody, you know, these sort of life events really shaped me. So, you know, going into that lifestyle and living in that area where I did and trying to get out afterwards is a big part of the journey. And, you know, then I got into writing books actually by accident. I never meant to be a writer, seriously, not my, but people kept on coming to me and said, hey, could you teach me how to handle it? Right, teach me about this stuff. And by that time I had learned it was a whole lot more than just physical. Okay. A friend of mine once said, you know, we were talking, I said, you know, I really hate the idea of going to Texas and, you know, seeing a bunch of drug rednecks dancing the Cotton Eye Joe. And, you know, this kind of scares me because I didn't know the rules. And you know, his comment was, come on, Mark, it's just common sense. If some guy tells you his wife's got a great pussy, you don't agree with him. And I thought, that's a unique way of looking at it. But that kind of common sense, or understanding that there are rules, there are ways that things are done in these areas, and a big part of safety is knowing what the rules are.
Right?
They are knowable, they are learnable, but a lot of people don't think about it that way. I mean, what can you do to avoid getting shot at, right? Also translates into what can you do to keep from pissing people off, or if you're going to do something that pisses people off, how do you handle it?
Right?
So, I mean, that was just growing up. Okay. You know, when I started writing, people were asking me to teach, and I got tired of repeating myself. So I swear, I was just going to sit down and write a little 10-page booklet, right, for my students. Like, here, okay, it was an ongoing thing, but, like, here, read this so I don't have to repeat myself. And, well, let's just say,
yeah,
I got sucked into this. And all of a sudden, what was supposed to be a little booklet turned into my first book, right? And then I was like, well, how do I publish this thing? What do I do? So, you know, I lucked out. I tried all the normal publishing routes. And then I had I knew a guy named John Donovan, who, this was one of those guys that, you know, he walks in the room and there's a gravity distortion.
Right.
Right. It's like, okay. And he and I just looked at each other and it was like, either we're going to have to ignore each other, become friends, or we're going to kill each other.
Right.
There'd be three options.
Yeah.
Right. And, you know, I come walking by and I look up and I see that he's got wings with a parachute. And I say, airborne? He goes, no, Green Beret, 27 years. oh, okay. Well, we became friends, and it turns out he was the demolitions expert of Soldier Fortune magazine, right? He was the editor for that. And, you know, we're sitting around one day, and I was like, John, I've got this book that nobody wants to publish. Let me see it, right? All right. It's like, here, I gave it to him. And I called him up later. I said, so what did you think? And he goes, I love the shit out of it. I made a phone call.
That's awesome.
You did what? Right? And voila, that's how I got introduced and published through Paladin Press. Right?
Isn't that a wild how it's these random meetings that you have, but it's not, you know, is it really random? You know, you can't necessarily say that, you don't know, but what's amazing is that story, that a version of that story is really through a lot of people that I've met that have, you know, ended up being something. It's usually that, but I also think it's tenacity too. I mean, the fact that you were so frustrated from having to repeat yourself and do things, it spurred you to do this. Then you find out, hey, I actually kind of like this. I'm good at it. I enjoy the challenge. And now you find an outlet for it. And Paladin Press, for those of, you know, I know we got a lot of millennials on here, and you know, Paladin Press was the that if you wanted the real information back then, if you wanted stuff where they were talking straight to you, outside of the martial arts magazines, which were, you know, really not where you get to get information, it was Paladin Press that you went to, it was Soldier Fortune magazine that you went to back then, because that's where you get realistic articles from authors like yourself. And it hooked in young guys like us, you know. Yeah. I mean, we were, my friends and I all just loved those books. And they were a unique group back then. They really published a lot of really interesting things. I mean, there's famous, you know, famously infamous stuff that that got put there, but they put out a lot of good quality info long before anybody talked about reality self-defense or whatever you want to call it today, you know.
And that was the stuff like I and Peyton Quinn, Sammy Franco, and Bradley Steiner, we were all been there, done that people. And instead of just talking about punching, kicking, and hitting, or what style it is, et cetera, you know, we were talking about what else comes with it and how to keep from triggering stuff, what you needed to do, to be aware, because when you're talking about people who are very, very violent, they are not only good at it, but they're really good at setting up so they can succeed.
Right.
And sometimes the only warning you're going to get is, well, okay, I have a story where this guy was in my face and, you know, I was letting him know exactly how much I didn't like this, you know, and what I thought about him. Yeah, I learned about that. And he crossed his arms. And there was just something wrong. I couldn't articulate, but my little antennas were going twitch, twitch, twitch. And I decided, you know what, it's time to jump back, right? Not just back away, but to jump back. And as I did, he went, and he came by with a butterfly knife, and this thing whipped right past my chest.
Wow.
Right? Oh, by the way that one ended, this incidentally was the only knife-to-knife incident I ever had. Because when I jumped back, I landed, I pulled out my knife and took, you know, the Applegate, the military fighting stance, if you will. And he suddenly realized that this had just turned into a knife-to-knife, not an assassination.
Right.
And he decided it was time to run away. Right. And being the ever tough man that I was, I turned to walk away and I threw up out of nerves. So, you know, there's all these things about violence that you won't learn, you won't realize, you won't understand why they're important until you've been there. Now, unfortunately, learning that and running into the first time can get you killed.
Right.
Right. So that's where I and, you know, the fellow pioneers of the time came out and were saying, look, you've never heard of this in your training, but this is real. This is an issue you will run across. Okay. And to this day, I still run into people who are like, no, you're making that up. Okay. Which,
that's the kind of stuff though that was so helpful, because when, you know, I was a military kid, and so I moved every 2 to 3 years.
Oh.
And so I all over the place, northeast, southeast, yeah. You know, west coast, you know, southern Cal. And like you said, you know, there are different rules everywhere you go, different cultural norms. And it usually, especially, you know, in the 70s, that involved fighting at every new school you're at and learning that. But what was interesting is, you know, my grandfather was good at that. But you just reminded me, he told me that he's the only guy that told me it's okay that after the fight, when you have that dump, that just dump of everything, if you throw up, if you, he would tell me, he goes, hey, there's no shame in that. It's normal. He goes, you get used to it.
Yeah.
And I got to tell you, Marc, that was more, having that in me was more valuable than anything else, because the after effects, which nobody ever talks about,
right,
were devastating. Had my grandfather not prepped me for that, mm-hmm. I would have thought there was something wrong with me.
Yes.
Or that maybe I didn't do it right, or maybe I'm a coward or whatever. Look, but
that's a huge issue. And, you know, there's certain things. I have a student who is going for his BA in psychology. And, you know, they had a list of things about the reactions to violence. And at the very bottom, it said erection.
Yes.
Right? Now, Grandpa probably didn't talk to you about that, because that's a little too awkward. But, you know, when you walk out after a situation and you're alive, it's like, man, you'd screw a snake if somebody put it in a sundress.
Yeah.
It just, oh, that's sick, that's twisted, that's wrong. No, that's human.
Yeah.
Right. And I mean, a lot of times when it comes to violence, we are our own worst enemy, right? And the tales that we tell ourselves about violence can really get us in trouble, right? But there are things that, like I said, until you're there, if nobody is giving you warning about them, it's going to pop up and it's like, what? You know, one of the things that I'm working on, and, you know, I get a whole lot of, no, you're making this up, until I start showing them videos, is a guy who is attacking, right? And when the person pulls out a gun and points it at, the guy stops. Now, you're looking down the barrel of a gun. What would you think would be two common reactions there?
I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, no, yeah, you either go for him, you know, you attack him right away, you get the hell out of there.
Right. That, you would think that those are two options.
Right.
The Whiskey Tango Foxtrot reaction is the guy is in the middle of a charge and you point a gun at him and he's like, this complicates things. What do I do now?
And that's funny.
He hasn't changed his intent, right? He's just like, well, this is a problem I didn't expect. How do I still get him? Right?
That's wild.
And that, believe it or not, is a legal nightmare. Right? Because now the cops are going to nail you for brandishing or felony menacing or whatever. You know, the fact is, this guy was attacking and gave you every reason you needed, right, to warrant that level of force, and instead of stopping and running, right, and I'm going to date myself, instead of stopping the VCR and popping out the VHS, he just pauses while he thinks, and I mean, you actually have to take control of the situation.
Yeah.
Right. But again, these are the problems that people don't expect. They don't believe is real until you've been there, until you've seen it. And if you do run into it and you've been warned, it's like, I know what this is. So that was what my writing was about, right? Helping people out. Well, the other thing is, since we're talking about my past, is I did something a lot of people don't do. And that is, I started writing. And then I went back into the violence professions, right? And I was checking out my theories. And there were things I discovered, bam, okay, that didn't work. Versus like, hey, you know what? That does work and it works better, right? A lot of this stuff, I have to admit that I just found by dumb luck, Okay. Now, with some education and, you know, other stuff, I can look back and say, yes, what I was talking about is pattern interruption, right? Psychology and all that. I had this guy who was barking and drooling at me in my face, you know, not actually, I don't let people get into my face, right? That's not something you want to do in weapons environment.
Right.
But, you know, he's barking and drooling, calling me everything, you know, every name in the book. And I don't know where this one came from, but out of nowhere, I said, you know, I hate to tell you this, but I've been called worse, and more accurately, I might add, by my mother. And this guy was like, I got nothing.
Yeah.
Totally interrupted his role, right? You know, it was a change of, then I talked the guy out, but the thing was, I started using that line anytime somebody was trying to get a rise out of me by being verbally abusive, right? So I began to look at the patterns of violence, what from a writer's standpoint, as somebody who's been there, came up with these ideas, and then let's see if what I'm saying is right. Okay. And that's where I began to really look into the patterns. And because I'm neurologically different, I have ADHD, my brain is wired differently. And one of the best explanations I ever heard for ADHD is it's like there was a handbook of life that they didn't get, right? Well, when they were handing out these handbooks of how to behave, I was in the boys' bathroom flushing a cherry bomb down the toilet.
Right.
I missed that memo.
Yeah.
So I had to learn as I went, right? And watching people, I would see things that other people don't see, right? They're there, but unless you're really looking for them, you don't see them, okay? The other thing that comes into experience is the first time somebody is howling, barking, drooling in your face, it's like, you know, you've got the adrenaline, or you're like, oh yeah, right? Well, you know, by the 56th time this has happened, you're calm enough now that you can begin to notice things, right? And you can start spotting patterns, and you can begin to see what happens if you fall for the strategy or if you counter it. Okay. You know, the comment about, you know, being called worse by my mother is a counter to him trying to work me up by, you know, quote, threatening me, et cetera, et cetera. So all this stuff got wrapped into my writing, got wrapped into my teaching. Then I became an actual regular teacher, where I was warning people about, hey, you need to watch for this. Okay, this is how these things happen. And if you see this developing, this means that. Be aware, right? Now, moving on to the last stage, you know, where I am now, which is one of those, how the hell did I get here? Right? I had been teaching, I taught at the Seattle, or Firearms Academy of Seattle. And they had started what was known as the Armed Citizens Legal Defense Network, which is people who handle, or they help lawyers handle self-defense cases. Okay. And you got these crimes, you got all these, but you also have self-defense that is being charged as crime. Okay, the saying of going to jail for self-defense or going to prison for defending yourself is real.
Yes.
Okay. Well, there had been a little soiree between the Hell's Angels and the Mongols in Laughlin, Nevada. I think this was 2001.
Maybe I remember that.
And by the way, soiree is code word for a riot.
Right. Yeah, it's interesting. My wife now is a deputy chief, but she was on that. She responded to that here in Metro. Because they run Laughlin as well. And that was famous. Like all my SWAT buddies, everybody still talks about that event.
Oh, yeah. Well, you know, there were shootings, stabbings, and all those other things. And one of the attorneys asked Marty Hayes from FAS, hey, do you know anybody who knows about knives? And he went, talk to Marc. Right. Well, let me see this. Send me all the information. And I was sitting there looking at this, and I knew what the charges were. And I mean, they actually, it wasn't just state, but feds had gotten involved and they were bringing RICO charges. And by that, you know, since there were deaths involved, everybody was facing life prison. I mean, life sentences, right? And they're like, we need to, you know what happened here. And I'm watching the videos and I was like, Watch something else. What the? Holy! Now, let me start by saying, having dealt with them personally, okay, I will not piss on most Hell's Angels if they aren't on fire.
Right.
Okay. What I'm about to say is proven if you know how to look in the videos, and I spent hundreds of hours watching the videos. The Hell's Angels walked into a planned ambush. It was a setup.
Yep.
Right. And it was just, wait a minute. And I did a 140-page report of the violence and all the things that were involved. Right. Handed him to the attorney I was working with. He looked at all the other angels. He looked at the report and handed it to all the other angel lawyers, right? And basically, at the end of the day, first of all, the federal charges out the window.
Right.
But then they were like, and the state charges got reduced to plea bargains. Right? So, yeah, it is a, you know, it was a horror story, but you know, when you really watch the dynamics of what happened, it is not simple. It's not cut and dry.
No, and you know, one of the interesting things too, just a tangent off that, you've been around
a while.
Extremely violent people. You've been around extremely violent gangs, people like that. I've similar, nothing like, you know, the experience you had, but I've been, you know, studying groups like that. The one of the things I find really interesting is there's this perception that everything's chaotic in those things. It's just random violence. I've found the more, like, especially when I go in depth in the federal pens and I'm studying the prison, I found it actually to be the opposite, that it's hyper rational. And that, you know, I tell a story all the time that a friend of mine who is a very famous, he just passed a couple of years ago, a very famous fitness trainer. He would go around the world and he trained a lot of cops, trained a lot of people. And the first thing he'd ask at a new city is he'd go, hey, what gym do all the ex-felons work in, work out at? Because he knew he'd get a great workout. Nobody was going to walk in front of you, grab weights, do anything like that. There's that thing. And could you just talk to a little bit about that? Because people really have misconceptions about those types of people. I mean, you kind of touched on an early saying, you know, you had to understand the rules going into a new area and stuff. But I found it actually far easier to navigate stuff like that than in upper society.
Yeah. You know? Okay. You ask a very simple question that has a kind of complex answer.
Yes.
So it's a...
And you're the perfect person for that answer.
Yeah. Okay. Let me back up. I'm going to date myself, and if you get your reference, you're officially old. Let's set the Wayback Machine. Okay. Most of what people think they know about violence comes from the losers. Okay. In other words, if people who say, well, you know, violence never works to solve a problem, if you say that, you're doing it wrong. Okay. For the record. But basically, let's say that there are four outcomes in general that can happen with violence. Number one, you lose. Number two, you win.
Yay!
Right.
Right. Number three is you fight to a standstill. Okay. And number four is you both go to the hospital. Okay. So the problem is the narrative about violence has been dictated by the losers. Okay.
Right.
And the stories that they tell are way different than the other four. Right. But because of the press and, you know, the experts talking about that, that really covers our perspective. So they think like victim and, you know, aggressor unchecked. Okay. And that just isn't the case. One of the things when you're dealing with people who are as competent with violence as you are, is you really don't want to kick it off for no reason. Okay. The young hotheads who, man, they want to make their name. They want to, you know, they want to go out and win. They want to be the aggressor. They're hot to trot. The old dogs who've been down, you know, been through it before are like, no. If we can find a way to avoid doing this, let's take that option, right? And a lot of times that also means not being an asshole,
right?
Right. So when you talked about, like, you know, finding a gym where the felons work out, everybody knows how to behave because they are really hot not to hand out offense because they know they can die over it. Right. And even if they win, there's a good chance somebody they know is going to die or they're going to go to the hospital. Okay. So there's a balancing act that goes on with between two groups of heavy hitters or individuals. I mentioned, you know, the three options John and I had. Okay. Either ignore each other, become friends, or go head to head. Now,
where I think people miss, you know, for people listening, where people get wrong is they hear that and they think they understand what you're saying. But I think what has to be predicated, you know, they have to understand this only works if there's a credible threat of violence, meaning all parties understand the reason you do these altercations, the reason you alter your behavior and you are not an asshole is because there is a credible threat of violence. Without that, you know, you're not going to have that. And I think that's what's really interesting is violence being kind of the overall, you know, it's almost like the nuke that's there that nobody wants to detonate.
Yeah, well, it's you both know that throwing nukes and to what you just said, I'm going to say yes and.
Right.
Okay. The next thing about it is they know, okay, there's levels of violence and levels of dangerous. And people who are adept at different levels conduct themselves differently. All right. Part of it is if you're a heavy hitter, a huge part of your survival is not showing everything. Okay, because there's always a question and you want to leave a question in their mind. See, if I come walking in with my gun on my hip going, hell, waha, better be afraid of me. People know how hard they have to land on.
Right.
Okay. It's like, okay, that dude, you know, what do? We come up behind him and, you know, cap him in the back of the head.
Right.
Right. It's the guy that they're not sure about. It's the guy that they go, you know, he's probably armed. The $64,000 question, though, is with what and where are they?
Right.
Notice I pluralize those.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And you know, it's a lot of these other things where you walk in and, you know, I'm a sci-fi nerd. I love it. I admit it. I'm a science and physics nerd, history too. And there's a really good scene in the movie Starship Troopers where they're in a spaceship and they're on the bridge and they're talking. It's late at night. The guy looks down and the coffee in the coffee cup is slanting, but the coffee cup is upright. Right.
Right.
And the guy goes, there's a gravity field out there. Okay. He didn't see the gravity field. What he saw was the effects of it.
Right.
Right. So part of this is like knowing when you walk into a place, look to see who's sitting in the corner or sitting in a place where they're back against the wall, who can watch the entire room. Because that is a preferred haunt of heavy hitters.
Right.
Okay, they're going to be quiet about it. They're going to be sitting there minding their own business, but they're also watching the room. Okay. These are subtle signs. These are not overt. You know, this isn't some guy walking in, I'm the biggest, baddest thing here. Right. Everybody, be impressed by the size of my penis.
Yeah.
Right? No, it's that guy sitting over in the corner, right? And once you learn these levels, these can be pretty much the only signs that you'll get from these guys, right? Until they act. And when they act, they tend to come in with massive amount of force. Now, part of the surprise here is the most dangerous men I have ever met in my life are all categorically polite, right?
Yep.
They don't want unnecessary violence, okay? They will do everything in their power possible to give you chances to walk away, to find other options, right? To not do something. But when they act, it's like, oh, man, did you have? That little action was to send a message, wasn't it? Right? So it's really weird that the difference between people who are very competent at violence and those who are trying to present themselves as competent. Right? Like I said, and this, by the way, mixes in with other stuff like different cultures, right? Different cultures get mad differently. Right, and you need to know that how a culture gets mad, because if you misread a certain culture, they will gut you like a fish.
Right.
Right. And again, these are things you have to learn, and these are the things that I started talking about in my teaching. Right. And you know, like I came up with 5 stages of violent crimes.
Which is the perfect place for us to stop, because that's where we'll pick it up on part 2. Now, again, Marc is, you know, there's a lot in that, if you got it. You know, his idea of, you know, how you can pick out, you know, people that understand violence in a crowd, what's important, you know, what is a threat, you know, and he's probably one of the few people out there that can talk with such depth on this. And it's because, you know, he's retained by a lot of attorneys, you know, which he bemoans. He does not necessarily enjoy his having to talk with attorneys all the time. But as you're going to find in some of the later parts of these interviews, he talks a lot about, you know, what, you know, the ideas of self-defense and a lot of things that people say all the time or tell you to say. He will enlighten you on what's going on, because that's really where he's gone. And I'd like to point out that there's a book currently, and I'm going to make sure, you know, over all the interviews should do this, but the one book that Marc was suggesting everybody get is actually up here. Let me pull it up real quick. Have it right here. It is this book, What You Don't Know Can Kill You. Now, I'll be doing this, but it's available on Amazon. There's another book that he mentions towards the end of the interview, but this is one that is one of his most recent. The ones I did earlier were the ones that I was introduced to as a kid, and that was early in Mark's career when he put that out, and people putting the titles out were sensational. Paladin Press had some of the most sensational titles that were out there. But this, obviously, you can see is really important. It's how most self-defense training will get you, you know, put in prison or in the ground. It's pretty stark, you know, on there. And you're going to learn more about that. So I'm really looking forward to the future interviews here. Now, to close out, again, folks, just reminding everybody, SurviveViolence.com. You know, get the free masterclass. Also ensures that if there's any monkeying around with the platform here, we can still get in touch with you. And, you know, people like Marc MacYoung, if they have something coming out, that's where we'll be sending the information out directly to you to let you know that. Now, if you like the channel also, please make sure you subscribe. Make sure you tell your friends. We've been growing exponentially. And a lot of it's due to you folks letting people know that this exists. And if there's one in particular video that you like, that you think is seminal, send it around to your friends. Let them know this channel is around, because I'm getting some great feedback and I really appreciate it. All right, until next time, stay safe.